Namaskar, good morning. You are watching Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Smriti Rastogi with Breakfast News. Let's begin the bulletin with the headlines. Situation under control and violence hit Northeast Delhi. Home Minister Amit Shah reviews situation. Two SITs formed to probe violence. Section 144 to be relaxed in affected areas for 10 hours. Eastern Zonal Council, chaired by Home Minister Amit Shah, to meet in Bhubaneswar. Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha and West Bengal to take part. Interstate water dispute, power transmission, infrastructure projects among issues to be discussed. U.S. President Donald Trump's visit demonstrates value America places on ties with India, says U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo. India-U.S. parliamentarians to hold an exchange visit for first time in April. Death toll due to coronavirus touches 2,800. As cases mount outside China, WHO says outbreak has reached pandemic potential. IMF World Bank set aside funds to fight the outbreak. President Ramnath Kovind to felicitate women scientists and communicators. National Science Day today with the theme Women in Science to commemorate discovery of Raman effect by Sir C.V. Raman. The Delhi Police has formed two SITs to probe violence in Northeast Delhi. The Delhi Police also transferred the Northeast Delhi violence probe to the crime branch. The SITs will be headed by Deputy Commissioners of Police Joy Tirki and Rajesh Deo. The situation in the violence-hit parts of Delhi remain under control as no untoward incident was reported for the second consecutive day on Thursday. The police has registered 48 FIRs as raids are being carried out in different areas as part of the probe.
मैं एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन का पार्ट होने के नाते मैं यहां पे आया, लोगों से बातचीत किया है और उनको अश्योर किया है कि उनके अगर दिमाग में अगर कोई अप्रिहेंशन वगैरह है तो उसको दूर करें और उनके तरफ से भी मुझे काफ़ी पॉजिटिव रिस्पांस आया है. वे भी इस बात को हमारे कुछ एक अश्योरेंस दिया है कि वो अमन कमेटी के थ्रू साथ में काम करेंगे. मैंने उनकी बातें सुनी, कुछ सजेशंस हैं जो पुलिस को जो आइंदा के लिए स्थिति सामान्य हमेशा बनाए रखे उसके लिए जो सजेशन दिए हैं उस पर हम काम करेंगे.
The Central Board of Secondary Education has postponed class 10th and 12th class exams scheduled for today and tomorrow in violence-hit Northeast Delhi. In a statement, CBSE said examinations in the remaining parts of the national capital will be conducted as per the schedule. The CBSE said the next date of exam for the affected students will be notified soon. The board also announced that it will conduct fresh exams for students who have not been able to appear for the papers in other parts of the national capital due to the violence in the Northeast Delhi. It has also sought details of the students who failed to appear for exams due to the prevailing situation in the city. And the Delhi High Court on Thursday adjourned the hearing on a petition seeking FIRs against leaders of the political parties for their alleged hate speeches. The case will now be taken up on 13th of April. The central government and the Delhi police have been given 4 weeks to file their affidavit on the issue. During the hearing, the Solicitor General said the time was not conducive to file FIRs related to the alleged hate speeches as the priority now was to ensure peace. And Union Minister Prakash Javrekar on Thursday lauded the Delhi police and other security personnel for restoring normalcy in Delhi, which saw unprecedented violence earlier this week. He asserted that the situation in violence-hit Northeast Delhi is under control. Arrests have been made and inquiries have been fast-tracked to identify culprits behind the violence.
पिछले दो दिनों से शांति कायम हुई है, जांच तेजी से चल रही है, गिरफ्तारियां हो रही है और हमें विश्वास है कि दोषी और इस साजिश बेनकाब होगी और सही दोषी जो है वो भी चिन्हित होंगे. ऐसे समय सबका काम है कि शांति मजबूत करें.
And Congress interim President Sonia Gandhi led a delegation of party workers to meet President Ramnath Kovind on Thursday. The Congress leader submitted a memorandum to the President seeking his intervention on the deadly violence that gripped Delhi earlier this week. The delegation included former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, leader of opposition in Rajya Sabha Ghulam Nabi Azad, Ahmed Patel and P. Chidambaram among others. And Union Home Minister Amit Shah will chair the 24th meeting of the Eastern Zonal Council, comprising states of Bihar, Jharkhand, Odisha and West Bengal, scheduled to be held in Bhubaneswar today. Chief ministers and chief secretaries of these states are likely to attend the meeting. Issues such as interstate water dispute, power transmission, coal royalty, forest clearance for railway and other infrastructure projects and extension of banking and telecom services in rural pockets will figure in the discussion. And after chairing the meeting, Amit Shah is scheduled to address a rally in Bhubaneswar in support of the amended Citizenship Act. Amit Shah will be on a two-day visit to Odisha from February 28th. And some other developments, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman met with trade and industry representatives, economists and policy experts in Guwahati on Thursday. During the interactive session, the minister said that the government is committed to steadily move towards less regressive regime and to help close all disputes pertaining to taxation. She added that local self-help groups will be given greater access to credit to supplement the economy. She also said that traditional industries in the Northeast should have facilities to exhibit themselves. The interactions are primarily oriented towards various themes and provisions in the Union Budget 2020-21 presented in the Parliament on 1st of February 2020. These interactions are part of a series of interactions which were held by her across the country after her budget speech in the Parliament.
What are the challenges faced in Assam because of either the banks not being present adequately or because of certain programs which are not happening, with a particular attention to the tea gardens, elaborately talking about the difficulties that in some parts of Assam, because of scant presence of banks, the kind of difficulties that are being faced.
And Niti Aayog's Atal Innovation Mission, in collaboration with the National Association of Software and Services Companies, announced on Thursday the launch of an artificial intelligence-based module for students in Indian schools. The AI-based module will be implemented across 5,000 Atal Tinkering Labs, empowering 2.5 million students. Niti Aayog CEO Amitabh Kant said that India can add 1.3% to its GDP on an annual basis through the use of machine learning and artificial intelligence. Speaking on the collaboration, Devjani Ghosh, president of NASSCOM, said that this will create right foundation for students and prepare them for the digital and AI era.
AI is very important because AI by 2035 will contribute to gross output of about 15.7 trillion, more than the GDP of USA and America. And another study shows that India can add 1.3% to its GDP on an annual basis through the use of machine learning and artificial intelligence.
AI has a potential of adding around 15 to 15.5 trillion to the world's GDP by 2030. And India, roughly, is supposed to be get around 1 trillion additional boost if we implement AI.
And Defence Minister Rajnath Singh has said that India will be a major exporter of defence equipment in the days to come. Addressing the HAL employees in Bengaluru on Thursday, he said that the defence exports that presently stand at 17,000 crore rupees will be enhanced to 35,000 crore rupees by 2024 through various government interventions. Calling HAL as a backbone of aviation sector in India, the minister asked the aeronautical manufacturing company to play a key role to take up Make in India program.
Economic development mein डिफेंस इंडस्ट्री का भी एक बहुत बड़ा कंट्रीब्यूशन रहा है और पिछले 5 वर्षों में भारत ने मेक इन इंडिया इनिशिएटिव के अंतर्गत मिलिट्री इक्विपमेंट की मैन्युफैक्चरिंग इंडिजनाइजेशन की दिशा में एक उल्लेखनीय प्रोग्रेस है। भारत का डिफेंस एक्सपोर्ट बढ़ रहा है। पिछले 2 वर्षों में हमारा यह एक्सपोर्ट 17,000 करोड़ रहा है, पर आप लोगों की कैपेसिटी को देखते हुए आगामी वर्षों में इसका लक्ष्य 2024 आते आते 35,000 करोड़ तक पहुंचेगा। इस संबंध में मैं पूरी तरह से कॉन्फिडेंट हूं और हिंदुस्तान एरोनॉटिक्स लिमिटेड इस लक्ष्य को पूरा करने में बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट रोल प्ले करेगा, यह मेरा पक्का विश्वास है।
And with that, it's time for a very quick breather. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Ministry has a very important scheme, which is Pradhan Mantri Kisan Sampada Yojana, with a total outlay of 6,000 crore rupees. But how do we further minimize the wastage of perishable items?
6,000 crores is primarily my focus has been in giving it for perishables, fruits, vegetables, marine, milk, all the kind of things which spoil very fast.
And of course, the budget talked about Krishi Rail and Krishi Udan as well.
While the passenger trains are going, let these farmers have an opportunity to send their produce to, you know, to a Bangalore, to a Delhi, to a Mumbai.
Now, export potential in the next 5 years, according to you, in this space?
Food processing sector, I think in the next 5 years, we should be able to double, if not do it 2.5 times of what we are today.
Watch To The Point with Harsimrat Kaur Badal, Union Minister, Food Processing Industries, only on Rajya Sabha TV.
What are some key legislations introduced in Rajya Sabha? Some of the key legislations introduced in Rajya Sabha are the Indecent Representation of Women Bill 1986, the Indian Succession Bill 1991, and the Marriage Laws Bill 1999.
Welcome back after the break. India and Myanmar on Thursday exchanged 10 agreements in various fields, including infrastructure, energy, communication and health. The agreements were exchanged following talks between Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Myanmar President U Win Myint in New Delhi. The agreements also included an MOU on cooperation for prevention of trafficking in persons, rescue, recovery, repatriation and reintegration of victims of trafficking.
I can tell you that if you look at the number of MOUs signed, there are at least 4 to 5 MOUs which are actually relating to socio-economic development. in that part of Myanmar, you know, the socioeconomic development of their kind of state.
President Ramnath Kovind met with a visiting dignitary at Rashtrapati Bhavan on Thursday evening. He said that India-Myanmar partnership is at the heart of India's vision to create a connected and cooperative neighborhood. And earlier in the day, the president of Myanmar was accorded ceremonial reception at the Rashtrapati Bhavan. He and First Lady Do Cho Cho were welcomed by President Ramnath Kovind and Prime Minister Narendra Modi. External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar also called on the visiting dignitary. Both leaders discussed a wide range of bilateral issues. He also visited Rajghat and paid tribute to the father of nation, Mahatma Gandhi. UN Mint arrived in New Delhi on Wednesday on a four-day visit to India. Today, he will visit the Mahabodhi Temple in Bodh Gaya. He will also pay a visit to the Myanmar Monastery and other Buddhist sites in the city. Tomorrow, on the fourth and the final day of his visit, the president will visit Agra. Meanwhile, first bus service from Imphal in Manipur to Mandalay in Myanmar will start from 7th of April. And U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo on Thursday said that President Donald Trump's just concluded India trip demonstrated the value the United States placed on its ties with New Delhi. In a tweet, Pompeo said that Trump's first official trip to India this week demonstrates the value the U.S. places on the U.S.-India partnership. He also said that democratic traditions unite us, shared interests bond us, and under the president's leadership, our partnership has and will only grow stronger. During his two-day historic India visit, President Trump visited Ahmedabad, Agra, and New Delhi. The U.S. congressional representatives and parliamentarians will hold an exchange visit for first time ever in April. Meanwhile, reminiscing her India visit, U.S. First Lady Melania Trump took to the Twitter and said, I quote, "Thank you, Sarvodaya School, for welcoming me with the lovely Tilak and Aarti tradition. I was inspired by the reading classroom and happiness curriculum programs at Sarvodaya School in New Delhi. Wonderful to see the principles of Be Best are not just limited to the US and can be found throughout the world." Unquote. And India and the US are set to sign the first phase of a mega trade deal soon under a model followed by Donald Trump administration in finalizing a similar deal with China. According to the official sources, India and the US have almost completed negotiations for the first phase of the ambitious deal, and it will be formalized soon. India and the US have also decided to launch talks on a totalization agreement, which relieves Indians from double taxation. The US and China inked an initial trade deal last month, ending an 18-month-long dispute. The two countries are now working on a final trade deal. And India has once again hit out at Pakistan for raising concerns over human rights in Jammu and Kashmir. Describing Pakistan as a pernicious cradle of terrorism, India slammed the neighboring country, saying that before preaching others, it must remember that terrorism is the worst form of rights abuse. Exercising the right of reply at the 43rd session of the Human Rights Council in Geneva, India's Vimarsh Arun said that over the past 7 months, India has undertaken a series of democratic and progressive legislative reforms in the region aimed to further protect the overall human rights of Indian citizens and to curb Pakistan's nefarious designs aimed at damaging the fabric of the Indian society. And the United States of America is set to sign a landmark peace deal with the Afghan Taliban in Doha on Saturday. India's ambassador to Qatar will attend the signing of the peace deal. India has been invited by the Qatar government for the ceremony. It will be for the first time that India will officially attend an event involving the Taliban. The deal would allow for the withdrawal of U.S. forces from Afghanistan. Another news on the status of coronavirus. The novel coronavirus has killed at least 2,800 people worldwide, the vast majority in mainland China. There have been more than 83,000 global cases with infections in every continent except Antarctica. The World Health Organization says the coronavirus outbreak has reached a decisive point and has a pandemic potential. WHO's head comments came as countries around the world battled to prevent the virus spreading further. For a second day, more cases have been reported outside than inside China. Iran and Italy have become major centers of infections, with people traveling from there spreading the virus further. Among measures taken by several countries, Japan and Iraq have ordered schools to close. Saudi Arabia is stopping foreign pilgrims from entering the country. Iran has urged citizens to avoid making unnecessary trips within the country and cancelled Friday prayers in Tehran and other cities. Italy, where 17 people have died, has quarantined 11 towns. Meanwhile, the International Monetary Fund and World Bank are ready to provide countries in need with immediate emergency funding to fight the coronavirus outbreak. IMF spokesman Jerry Rice said that this at a press conference. He said that while the institutions have yet to receive a request for aid, they have now developed contingency plans. The IMF has already said that the fast spreading coronavirus will have an impact on global economic growth and is likely to downgrade its growth forecast as a result. And President Ramnath Kovind will present awards to felicitate women scientists on National Science Day today. Women in Science is the theme of this year's National Science Day. A total of 21 awards will be given, which will include National Science and Technology and Communication Award, Augmenting Writing Skills for Articulating Research Awards, and National Award for Young Women Showing Excellence through Application of Technology for Societal Benefits. The day is celebrated every year to honor scientist C.V. Raman. On this day, he had announced the discovery of the Raman effect, for which he was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1930. Vice President M. Venkaiya Naidu has said that remarkable contributions by the scientific community has improved the well-being of humans. He also urged all the scientists and researchers to use science and technology to make people's lives comfortable and happier. And Prime Minister Narendra Modi saluted the talent and tenacity of our scientists, saying that their innovative zeal and pioneering research has helped India and the world. He said that the government is making numerous efforts to create a better environment for research and innovation in India. And now let's talk about the environment and climate change. European countries need to invest to prepare their transport infrastructure for the impacts of climate change. A recent study by UN Regional Commission has examined how extreme weather can wash out bridges and how rising temperatures can cause railway tracks to buckle. The UN report also warns that heavy flooding caused by Rhine River in Germany will affect roads, waterways, as well as rail routes. The study also found that 60% of the European seaports are at high inundation risk by 2100. The study suggests revision of technical requirements for infrastructure construction. And that's all we have for you in this edition. Thank you for watching. Namaskar.